Humans and their machines are the winners of evolution. Now they're alone in the tiny world they created. Secluded in their noble bureaus, towering above the city, humans are the rulers of all. Meanwhile, the machines serve their creators, keeping the ever-turning gears moving and mining the humanity's wealth from the ground deep down below. When one of them discovers beauty amidst the darkness, he starts developing emotions. A major defect. An unwound clockwork.
Yes, that's an unwound clockwork, just a small glimpse of it. And for the German speaking among you, the German title would be Das Getriebe im Sand. That's another title you will find when searching for it. And yeah, as said in the beginning, an unwound clockwork is a steampunk stop-motion movie. And what this means basically is steampunk is like an alternative imagination of the future. Let's say the people in the 1800s would have thought about, hey, how will the year 2023 would look like? And let's say no electronics would have developed, and instead of that, all the steam machines and mechanical contraptions we had would have developed further, and our entire world would be driven by steam still. That's maybe how today could look like in this alternative universe, basically. And steampunk, in that regard, is not really a genre, it's just an aesthetic, and you can place all sorts of stories in that setup. And stop motion, on the other hand, is a movie animation technique. You probably heard of it. It's like you have these little puppets and sets and just make a picture of it and then move the puppet a tiny bit further and make another picture and repeat that process thousands of times until you create a movement and scenes. And yeah, so everything you're seeing is actually handcrafted, and there's no CGI in that movie. And yeah, that's also part of the reason it took 10 years so far. Yeah, and also I'm working on it since, I guess, 2012. I was 18 years old back then, and so all the story and ideas about it, basically what an 18-year-old made up, and in the meantime I changed, but I have to stick to my original ideas. So yeah, it's also something where you can see how the artist changes throughout the movie, probably. But maybe that's also what makes it interesting. And yeah, for the story I'm telling here, it's a fantastic dystopia, basically. It's set in a world at the brink of collapse, and it's only inhabited by humans and robots, like no animals, no plants. And the humans are the rulers of this society. They're kind of the upper crust, while the robots are just the working class, the slaves of the humans, basically. But they're not mere machines. They're also very high developed and have emotions and intelligence. So yeah, that's basically the setup, and you can already see like, it's very obvious from the trailer also that it covers topics like social injustice and the human influence on the environment, but that's just kind of what's obvious. Beneath that are also some philosophical questions about what makes us humans, what makes us different from machines at all. Maybe we're slowly becoming our own creations, so there's also kind of a touch of So it has all these very modern ideas, but a very retro, old school, vintage style with this old steampunk look. And I think it's accidentally steampunk. I didn't head out to create a steampunk movie, it's just I had this critical, social critical story in mind, and it developed into a rather fantastic world, and this was just the aesthetic which happened to feel fitting for that character and that story. And I think it's good if the style matches the story you're telling, so it's not not just style, it's also, yeah, it matches the substance, hopefully. The creation of this world in the movie involves a lot of different handcrafts and steps to get to the final image. Of course, it starts in the brain by planning and imagining all the details, but then the first real step is to build all the sets and characters and props. That's also a very major part of the entire production. And then, before the actual animation can start, it's also a difficult and important step to set the lighting of the scenes properly, so it really feels like a living world and not just like a dollhouse you're watching. So lighting is very important, and directing the camera, planning out all the movements before you actually start animating. And yeah, then the animation process, of course, is also very tedious, frame by frame, by hand, manually. But it's not not completed when the animation is done. Then it's just a whole bunch of images, and to create the final look, there's a lot of post-production involved. Nothing in the movie is computer generated, but of course computers are used to bring together different footages, like there's the animation itself, then there's usually footage of the sets from the animation, but without the puppets, so you have something to remove little rigs and optimize little flaws in the image. And then I'm adding textures like clouds and smoke and flames, whatever the scenes needs to create this atmosphere around it. And in the entire process, it's very important for me to keep it visible that it's handcrafted. Like, don't make it over perfect. I want that it's visible, that things were found objects, or that how the things were created with tiny scratches and tool marks. And in some way I feel if it's visible that the movie world was created, it feels more real. It's at least for me it works like this. You see that this object exists somewhere. It might be smaller than it appears on screen, but it's actually built. And that's also something which is very important for me, and the steampunk aesthetic, because a lot of the steampunk is about finding things and reusing them. Like, for example, here in the footage, that's a big clock I built for the movie, but I recycled actual little old clockworks and scrap metal and put it all together. And built a workshop and learned a lot of techniques, I got more and more specialized in what I'm doing, but it's also important to stay true to the start, basically, to the beginnings. And in the movie it will be visible that there's a development, but it still should look like it's from the same people. But of course, all the things here are what I've done in the last 3 or 4 years, when I already had quite a bit of proper tools and the knowledge how to work with brass and other metals and stuff. And back in the beginning, it was just, we want to create a movie, let's start. And it was really learned by doing, figuring things out, and doing a lot of trial and errors. There are also a couple of errors left in the movie, I think. But it feels very organic that way. And as I said, I was 18 years old when the project started. Now I'm 29, and I started it together with a friend. That's 2013. The rough model from the mining set, and that was quite a while back. And we learned a lot. And by now, I'm also sometimes doing work for other stop motion productions, like building armatures and stuff. But that's already very advanced, and I want to show you how I got there, because I think an important message of my work is also that everyone can create things, you just have to start. And so the next clip I brought is a rather old making of, which shows kind of the beginnings of the project. It's from 2013, and it's still, the things which are visible there still ended up in the movie and made up for some scenes I'm still happy with, but it's just like much more low budget, easy approach. We just started like this.
Thank you.
besides just really basic hand tools, and it was still possible to create like the first third of the movie, basically. But of course, since then, a lot has happened, and everyone involved developed, mostly myself, because I worked on it for the entire duration of the 10 years. And with each character, with each prop, with each set I build, I get more experienced, of course, and each one of those little details from the entire project is a little project on itself. And so, while I got more experienced, also the expectation to the quality I had grows. And with every new little sub-project, basically, I wanted to push my limits further and try out something new. So now when I look at those older things, sometimes I feel I know much better how to do it now. And for example, this is a more recent set, and from the start it was conceptualized much differently to be really rigid and modular, so you can take it apart, which makes the animation and setup process much easier. And this set was had completed shooting now 1 year ago. We did the last scene on that set in November, and so another one completed. The entire film, by the way, has around 14 sets, and we're currently working on number 13, so only one major set left to go. So it already feels like on the finish line. Yeah, and all the things from the old making of, many of those I try to do better later. For example, one thing which looked really nasty for me in hindsight are those hands we cast, the first ones with rubber latex and wire fingers, and I was very not pleased with them, and I headed out to create better fingers for stop motion, and so I developed those fully articulated hand armatures. They are about 3 centimeters from wrist to fingertip, and they have real joints and are a stainless steel armature. And those hands now, they are much more sophisticated and look much better, of course. And this is also turned into a little product I'm now selling to other stop motion productions. Sadly, not to the big ones yet, but we'll see. I just have a lot of fun with figuring things like this out. Another one was the head of the human. In the early days, we just used clay heads and sculpted the expressions. But clay is really nasty to animate if not everything is from clay. The human had real clothes, and so the clay got dusty and dirty really quickly, and you can't clean it properly, and you always get sticky fingers, which you then rub onto the clothes and things. So also something you wanted to improve. So later I made this skull armature. It looks a bit weird, but it's a piece, a brass mechanism. And those pieces can be moved with little screws, which are hidden below the hair piece. And so the new human has a silicone face with this mechanism inside, and with the little screws we can adjust the eyebrows and the mouth, like you can look a bit more grim or a bit more laughing. Not very much, the expressions are very subtle. And then my specialty is kind of the metal work. I just love time mechanisms, so this little pocket watch was something where I tried to push the limits in terms of size. There are 2 shots in the movie where you see the inside like this, and it moves and ticks, and you see my fingers here in comparison, and the tiny little toothpick I'm using to rotate the wheels, because everything can be moved, but it doesn't move by itself. It's not functional like a pocket watch, but it looks functional in the movie. And the same with this typewriter. This is kind of a hero prop. It's a fully functional typewriter, and was one of the most fun things to make in recent years, and also a great opportunity to know update video each month where I show what happened in that month, and then there are sometimes if we completed something major like a new set or a new puppet, then there might be special videos only about this topic or general stop motion topics. Yeah, so that's basically how this project works behind the scenes. Now, maybe if you're still interested, I can tell you a bit more about some characters of the story. Do you want to see them? Yeah. See a bit more? So, yes, back to the story. As I said, in that society, only humans and robots still exist. And our main human character is kind of an official bureaucrat, let's say, working in middle management or something like this. I don't know, but he's a paper worker. Don't know the correct word. And he mostly decides things and processes papers, but he doesn't really know what the consequences of his decisions are. He's very detached, and but still he's convinced about the importance of his work, of course. So the fact that he doesn't really see the world he's living in is also shown by the fact that our humans don't have eyes and ears. They have very reduced faces, and that was also a kind of stylistic decision because I like a bit of an abstract, surreal touch. And it fits their character quite well because they're not the good guys in the story. So I have a little clip from the movie which shows the morning routine of that human character and his way to work. Thank you. also one of the working robots in the mines, and he basically just carries stuff around, and that's his job. And similar to the human, he also don't know the reasons behind his task, he just has to do them. But on one occasion, something happens, which you're going to see, which changes him, and he starts to question what he's doing, what's the reason for his existence, and maybe he should start stopping, just obeying the rules. So that's where the real story will start, and I have a little introduction to the robots and their minds as well.
Von den kalten Schlägen Stahls auf Stein. Nach Entdeckung des Wunderstoffs hatte man begonnen, die Erdoberfläche aufzureißen, jeder danach gierend, ein Stück des Kuchens abzubekommen. Und während die Erde zerbröckelte, wuchsen die Metropolen in den Himmel. Fahlen Fels und gähnenden Abgründen konnten nur noch Maschinen arbeiten. Eine dieser Maschinen war Nummer 142.
Or I'm doing it as a job now, basically, for the last 2 years. And so something back as well. So there are many digital rewards and also merchandise. And one special thing I also do every month is to build a little series of very small miniatures. And yeah, you can get some real pieces from the movie as well if you're interested. So yeah, I think that's about all I can tell for now. And so thank you all very much for attending this little presentation. And if there are any questions, then you look like you're able to take questions now, and I will try to answer them. Something completely different, but when starting this project, it wasn't really planned to make it into a profession, because I knew doing this for a profession is really hard, like with any arts. And so I wanted just to have a safe backup, and also I really enjoyed learning how machines work. But then I worked at this job for a year, and it was quite boring for me, and I really missed out on my project. And then I decided, yeah, I'm now going all in and trying to be a stop motion movie maker, and that's what I'm trying to be, and still figuring out how this can work. But from the handcraft perspective, I didn't learn anything professionally, but from early ages on, I always built stuff, and also many of my family members are kind of craftsmen people, so yeah. Yeah, you just start making things and figuring things out, yeah. May I run from a microphone so it's in the stream as well?
Sure. How do you plan to publish the film?
We're not sure yet, but first of all, there will be film festivals, of course, to maybe show it to the film world first. And then for the general audience, we hope to kind of get it on some streaming platform. I'm not sure yet. I have someone who's a producer who will take care of this. Of course, I would prefer to just release it for free, but as you can imagine, doing a project like this and having all these people involved takes a lot of money, and a lot of people are investing a lot of time in it, and so we will try to make some money back of it. But for me, it's very important to make it available, like not have it rot in the desk. I want people to be able to see it, so what I will make sure is that there's a physical release on disc, so all the people who support the project will get a disc in the end, at least. And otherwise, how it will be distributed digitally, I don't know yet, and I also can't do it myself, because that's the professional film world, and I don't understand this really. It's strange. But someone will take care of it, I guess. Yes. honestly, I can't wait to start something new. But it won't be a movie. It will be something completely different. And actually, I would like to talk with Martin about it. But I will not mention it publicly yet. But I already got annoyed from making movies, because I kind of, with the people involved now,
I kind of get a glimpse into the professional movie production world. And the more I see of it, the more I know I don't want to participate in that business. It's just no fun anymore as soon as you are talking about big budgets and studios and stuff. And the ideas I would like to make are just not possible with little money. So yeah, let's make something completely different. No movie at all. But I will keep doing things in a similar style.
My question is about the history of maker scene over the last 10 years and what you're doing, because you now hired professionals 10 years after starting, and typically the role of a maker scene is enabling you with things you don't know since you're not a professional, but you can still suck up all that knowledge from other people. Did that exist, or are there like 50 million things you're now regretting? Shit, I should know that. I should have known that 10 years ago, and it would have been 50 times easier.
Yeah, there are definitely a lot of things where I made it unnecessarily hard. On the early days, we just shot the animation, one take, and that's it. And as soon as you start thinking about post-production, you really want to have clean plates. That's like an image of the scene without the character, and you want different lighting exposures and all these things which make post-production so much easier. And now you only have this take and have to make it work, and yeah, it would have been easier to learn it from the start, or yeah, learn from professionals. But then again, it's really great to discover things yourself, I think, so I don't regret it really. It's okay, it's just difficult. And the reason to bring in professionals was mostly just to get it finished at all, because a couple of years ago I was facing a task which just felt too great to ever complete. I think in that regard Martin could feel it. And I really wanted someone to help me. Please help me finish this, basically. And luckily there were people willing to help. But also, professionals are the minority in the team. It was two occasions where professionals did one job for a couple of weeks or something. Most of the team are just hobbyists who also just learn by doing or learn from me in the meantime, and do it for fun mostly. Not sure if that answered the question, but...
One more question. It's a bit similar to this. So you showed this your workshop. I mean, it looks really elaborate and expensive, like this machines and this stuff. So my question was, are you renting in some kind of workshop, or is it really yours that you build it up and you ask professionals how to build it up and everything?
My workshop is actually just one room in my apartment. So it's not, it looks bigger on screen. It's just a normal living room in the third floor, which also limits the kind of machines I can put there. Actually, the cheapest and best machines would be old industrial machines, like 50 years old, but those weigh tons. And the little mill. This is the only expensive tool I bought, but it's also only kind of semi-professional. It's not really an industrial tool. I wish I had better tools, but I'm very limited in that regard. And also the metal work all remained on my side. The stuff I outsourced to other people always were things I didn't felt comfortable about myself. Like, I know what I can, but in the meantime, I also know what I'm not good at. And I think it's good to realize that and accept to not be able to do everything yourself and collaborate. And that's also, yeah, exchanging ideas is very productive. Sometimes if you work all by yourself, you're losing the big picture. So I really enjoy working with others as well.
What happened to the stages where you have finished filming?
Some of them got destroyed, actually. For example, the mine set where all the robots worked, this one is no more. Two reasons. First of all, after we were done shooting, it wasn't that pretty anymore. You have to imagine every time a character does a step, you have to drill a hole in the set and screw down the foot so it can hold in that position while it's doing the next step. And after a character has walked a couple of meters, then the set is just a Swiss cheese and it's not pretty anymore. And sometimes you really have to do nasty things to your puppets and sets, like minor spoiler, parts of the mines get destroyed in the movie, and so I really cut off pieces and glued on different pieces with hot glue, and it really didn't look good anymore. And also, the set was wider than the door frame, so that's the best reason to scrap it after filming. But I regretted that a bit, because it's nice to show people where things were done, and also, put the little puppets in the sets later. So for the interior sets, which are much more compact, I made sure to keep them in a stage where they are able to be exhibited in at some point. So the office sets will both remain, and there's kind of a cellar where it's a courtroom with brick wall, and so that's a box like this big, so that's also something I'm going to keep. In the meantime, my cellar is full of old sets, but at some point I want to exhibit all the pieces.
How are you making all the little clothes? You said they're from like actual fabric?
What, sorry?
The clothing, you said it was fabric that you're making it from, or is it clay? The characters, their clothing?
The puppets?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The clothing.
The clothes. Sorry, I didn't catch it. In the beginning it was clay, but clay turned out to be not that good to work with because it gets dirty very quick and your fingers get dirty from it and everything gets full of clay. In the meantime, we're using silicone, like this stretchy rubbery material, and it gets casted into molds. And for the clothes, it's just normal cloth. We're trying to find a very fine cloth so the texture feels not too big, but that's nothing special. Sometimes we incorporate black wrap, that's a thick aluminum foil beneath the cloth, so it's not flimsy. But that's also not optimal. On the most recent thing we're working on, the newest video on YouTube, if you watch it, there you can see the boss character. It's a really thick human, and he has some sleeves with this aluminum foil inside, and it's really wrinkled. It's not optimal. I'm not happy with it, but again, learning by doing. Or any other parts of the puppets where you are unsure? we can also talk later more. I'm not sure about the time. I think someone wants to start something else already. You know.
I don't because I just took over.
Yeah. But maybe if you want to see a piece, there's this little guy sitting here. He was also for a brief moment visible in the trailer, and that's one of the robot characters. One of the early ones I made, not a very sophisticated one, but that's someone who's already finished his scenes, and so you can take him and see how he moves and open his little chest door. So if you want to play with a puppet from the movie, that's your chance. And also, in the beginning, not very much were present, so if you want to see the trailer again, I could put it up again for the last couple of minutes. Then we can do that again, if that's fine for you as well.
Says you should stop more or less right now, so there is enough handover.
Yeah, then I
so, but if you find a spot on the side for more discussion, of course.
So no trailer again. Okay, sorry. Then maybe you have another chance tomorrow or Sunday. I don't know yet. It's up to the team to decide if I have another talk.
He said you can play it again.
Ah, okay. The trailer is on YouTube as well, but the other videos I showed are not public. The public video are different kinds. Oops, sorry, that's the wrong screen. Maybe I just skip back again. It's not. Boop, 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 boop. Okay.
Clockwork.